I forget, we're using, folks, you're welcome to come to the booth.
Lovely all.
At the end of the year, there's one period. You said with I'll walk to you rather than
just. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Susan Cordier, and I'm one of Ken's 10 children. It's my greatest honor to be representing the family this morning, as I share some thoughts on the life and memory of Cameron Cochran. Cam was born and raised in Sydney, Cape Breton in 1925. When he was just 21, he spotted a pretty redhead named Frances McAdam. And he kept his eye on her for quite some time before outright stealing her from another man's arms. Dad adored Frances and always said she was known as the prettiest girl in Sydney. They married in 1948, and by 1963, they had 10 children. Dad was a true provider. He built our first family home in Sydney, or at least he claims to have built the home. Knowing Dad's construction prowess, we're pretty sure he may have found a good group of guys to build him a home while he handed over the nails and the beer. Whatever the case may be, he was awfully proud of that house at 303 Cabot Street. Dad was one in a family of McCaffrey athletes who some would say ruled the Cape Breton sports scene. Whether it was bowling, baseball, hockey, curling, or golf, Dad was a consummate athlete. He was a fierce competitor. If you had met him at the bowling alley, you would know that he held the title of Cape Breton bowling champion in the mid-1940s. If you had met him on the baseball field, you would know that in those days, he loved baseball above all other sports. And he was a very accomplished catcher, home run hitter, and all-around player who had so many cherished memories of his days teamed up with his two brothers and his best friend, the team's pitcher, Lefty McDonald. Word on the street was that Dad and Lefty, as a pair, were a force to be reckoned with on the infield. If you had met Dad at the rink, you'd know he may not have been the best hockey player in Sydney. But that was okay, because there was another rink in town. Yes, that's right, Dad was a curler, and a fine curler he was. He continued curling long after we moved to Dartmouth, and he used to call it his off-season sport, because the minute the snow melted, Dad hit the links. And if you had met Dad on the golf course, you would know that he had a true passion for the game of golf. He was a dedicated member of Brightwood, where he developed many genuine and lasting friendships over the years. Several years ago, I invited Dad to his granddaughter's high school graduation. The ceremony began at 2 p.m. and by 3 o'clock, just as they were getting to the surname starting with F, I could sense Dad fidgeting in the seat. Now, our last name starts with K, so I knew it wouldn't be long before his granddaughter would be called to the stage. But I could feel him getting antsy. I'm thinking to myself, well, maybe Dad needs to go to the washroom. So I said, Dad, are you okay? And he leaned over and he whispered, I have to go. I said, okay, go ahead. They won't be calling me for a while. You have time. And with that, he grabbed his coat and he said, yeah, because I really have to go. I have a tea time at 3:20. And that was Dad. He was gone. Always balancing his passion for sport with his passion for family. He loved his family beyond measure. He and Mom raised 10 children, 5 boys and 5 girls, in a home filled with love, faith, music, patience, and kindness. Dad was so proud of his children. In fact, each one of us was pretty sure that we were the hands-down favorite, because that's exactly how he made you feel when you were with him. And being with him felt like a big warm hug. As the family got bigger, Dad's joy in his 28 grandchildren could only be overmeasured by a 40-foot pup. His door was always open, his heart always full. He would brim with pride at the accomplishments of each grandchild, even if he could only get half of their names straight. He and Mom had built their life on a foundation of love, and we were all the lucky beneficiaries of their union. Dad was a salesman extraordinaire. This speaks to his natural ability with people from all walks of life. When he wasn't selling meat and poultry, he could be found in the offices of the bookkeepers, taking orders for Mom's hand-knit hats and mittens. He used to say he kept her craft business alive, so she would have something to do all day. I don't know, I guess if he wore 10 kids were fending for themselves and running rampant around the streets of Sydney. Dad was an ambitious and dedicated employee who prided himself on the fact that he never missed a single day of work in 36 years. He was a man of strong reputation and integrity. He won many trips as top salesperson with Swift Canadian Meatpackers, and he and Mom flew off to destinations such as Las Vegas, Nassau, New York, just to name a few. Dad's career path took him to Dartmouth, where the family settled. He continued in the meat industry with Provisioners Maritimes until his retirement at the age of 65. In 2006, Mom passed away suddenly, and life changed for Dad. A few years later, he caught the eye of Elizabeth Walker. Dad and Betty dated for a couple of years before marrying in 2012. They shared several happy years together in a loving and caring relationship until Dad's health began to decline and he was moved into Camp Hill. Dad resided comfortably at Camp Hill for the past 5 years. The family is forever grateful to the staff of Camp Hill who cared so lovingly for him during his time there. Dad loved each and every one of his caregivers, and we will never forget their kindness to him. Dad's spirit will live on in his children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. May they embody all of his kindness, generosity, work ethic, athleticism, and the zest for life that made him shine. While we may feel some relief in knowing that Dad is now at peace and free of any pain or discomfort, there is still much sadness in our hearts. Although he is no longer with us here on earth, he left us the legacy of his love and his exuberance for life. He knew how to make everyone around him feel special. He knew how to laugh and enjoy real connection. He lived by the golden rule, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. He embraced life, even when life handed him hardship. They say grief is the cost of love. Looking around the room today, there is grief, but there's no mistaking the fact that Dad loved and was loved by so many. Let us remember the twinkle in his blue eyes, the smile that lit up any room he entered, his warm heart, and most of all, his love of family. And when you see the first butterfly this spring, Know that it is His Spirit touching you from a place where He is free, reunited in love, and forever home.
On behalf of the camp's family and on behalf of Divine Mercy Parish, I welcome each and every one of you to this Eucharistic celebration. I know some of you are not officially the members of the Catholic Church. However, we are all Christians and we are all God's children. We all believe in Jesus Christ and in the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. So very warm and cordial welcome to all of you. Today we celebrate the life and memory of a great human being who was lovingly called Cam. He loved much and he was even though loved much. Since we gathered together in his memory, I invite all of you to kindly close your eyes for a few moments and think of what Cam had been to you in your life. And thank God for the gift of this wonderful and noble man in your life. Stay silent for a few seconds. his wonderful mercy in our lives. We also pray to God to forgive Cam all his sins and to forgive us our sins. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Our God, Almighty Father, who has strengthened us by the mystery of the cross, and promised us a share in the mystery of your Son's resurrection, mercifully grant, we pray, that your departed servant can may be gathered into the company of your chosen ones. We make this prayer through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Now, if I didn't know what to come up to do the first reading.
First reading, a reading from the Book of Wisdom. The souls of the just are in the hand of God, and no torment shall touch them. They seemed, in the view of the foolish, to be dead. And their passing away was thought an affliction, and their going forth from us utter destruction. But they are in peace. For if before men, indeed they be punished, yet is their hope full of immortality, chastised a little, they shall be reaped blessed, because God tried them, and they are redeeming himself. As gold in the furnace, he proved them. And as sacrificial offerings, he took them to himself. Those who trust in him shall understand truth, and the faithful shall abide with him in love. Because grace and mercy are with his holy ones, and his care is with his light. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
And they unknown my heart.
Second reading.
Second reading. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, are you unaware that we were baptized into Christ Jesus, were baptized into his death? We were indeed buried with him in baptism into death, so that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live in newness of life. If, then, we have died for this, we believe that we shall also live with him. We know that Christ, raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has power over him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks.
Thanks. Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you. Wife Betty, beloved children Michael, Colleen, Bonnie, Timmy, Sean, Mary Paula, Jenny, Susan, Baba, and Paul, Camp's siblings, Dolores and York, daughters in law, sons in law, grandchildren, great grandchildren, relatives and friends. On behalf of the Divine Mercy Parish, I extend to you my my heartfelt condolences and sympathies on the passing away of your beloved dad, Ken. May his soul rest in peace. Affectionately called by family and friends as Ken, he passed away peacefully on the 13th of this month. As to life, even at the time of his death, Ken was surrounded by his loving family. He was 98 and had a life well lived. It is not easy to describe this consummate person. Ken lived a life filled with energy, enthusiasm, excitement, fun, and joy. He was a person who never seemed to have a bad day. He would always be remembered by his energetic passion for life. He loved deeply and was cherished by his 10 children, 28 grandchildren, and 13 great-grandchildren. At the young age of 17, in 1943, Ken enlisted and trained with the RCAF. During his training, he survived an aircraft crash. Later, he had a 36-year long and industrious career in sales with Sixth Canadian Meat Tigers. During this long period of work, Ken never missed a day of work. Ken was also a naturally gifted athlete. An exemplary father and grandfather, he was 100% a family man. He was very proud of his accomplishments and of all their activities, whether they were dancing, hockey, or writing stories. He was also the genealogist of the family. Doing researches into his family and trying to bring together the extended family members. A social butterfly, Ken enjoyed the company of others and loved to have people dropping in. He set a very high standard for his children. Your dad always saw good in people around him and had a very optimistic attitude towards life. Today's first reading, which he chose from the Book of Wisdom, says that the souls of the righteous people are in the hands of God. That is, your dad is now experiencing God's hospitality. God has graciously received your dad back to himself, giving him a share in eternal life. So, at this moment, your attitude should be one of gratitude to God. Today's first reading also says that death is not a disaster, but a transition to a new form of life, where your heart is at peace. He has gone back to where he came from. The only choice is that your life found great joy in nature and always delighted in the presence of songbirds feasting on his prized lowly bushes. Not many people consider loving and caring for animals and the environment as an important aspect of their spirituality. Love and care for the nature and animals is deeply biblical and Christian. Jesus says in the Gospel according to Matthew chapter 6, that your Heavenly Father feeds the birds of the air and the lilies of the field. God doesn't feed the birds and animals directly. He does it with the help of human beings. So when Cam fed the songbirds, he was truly following the teachings of Jesus of the Gospels. In today's Gospel, according to John, Jesus said, "In my Father's house there are many rooms." This saying of Jesus is not to be taken literally. Rather, it should be taken as a metaphor. When Jesus says that there are many rooms in his Father's house, he is not pointing to a geographical place. He is not pointing to a mansion in the sky. Instead, he is referring to the heart of God. In my Father's house, there are many rooms, means that God has a Catholic heart. That is, a heart that is so large that it can embrace everyone without bias or discrimination. The Greek writer Nikos Kazantzakis wrote, "The bosom of God is not a ghetto. The bosom of God is not a ghetto. It is wide open and antithetical to everything that is factual, fundamentalist, and ideological. It is a heart that does not divide things up according to ours and theirs. In other words, God has a Catholic heart, means that God has a large and magnanimous heart. Similarly, your dad, too, had a Catholic heart, wide open and ready to embrace everyone. That is why you could write in the obituary that he always exuded kindness, generosity, and compassion." The obituary also says that despite being a fierce competitor in life, your dad possessed a soft heart and cried easily and unabashedly at sad stories and movies. Truly, Cam, your dad, was a huge and the ocean of Catholicism. That is, an ocean of generosity, prodigality, and compassion. There are very few rooms in our hearts. The modern world needs Christians like your man, who can bring people together in relationship. Therefore, as we celebrate Camp's Christian life today, let us thank God for the great and noble soul that he had been. And let us try to emulate his exemplary life as a devoted husband, a loving father and grandfather, and a very committed Christian. May his soul rest in peace. Amen. Now we have the prayers for the faithful. I invite you to kindly stand.
For Cam, a loving husband, father, and grandfather, who loved his family and God, may he now dwell in God's heavenly home. We pray to the Lord. For Cam's family, may we continue to be inspired by Cam, who lived a Christian life to the fullest. We pray to the Lord. For our deceased relatives and friends, especially Francis, who we still miss today, may they be at peace in the arms of Jesus and eagerly now welcome Cam into God's heavenly home. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all caregivers, especially the staff at Camp Hill, who showed great compassion and care for Cam, we pray to the Lord. For all assembled here in loving memory of Cam, help us, Lord, be faithful to you so that we may someday be united with you in heaven. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God, my loving Father, we ask you to look upon us with mercy and compassion and grant us the grace that we have asked for. We make this prayer for Christ our Lord. Please be seated.
Thank you.
and others that this sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Let us pray. As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Paul, we beseech your mercy that he, who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior, may find in him a merciful judge. We may pray for Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your heart. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has gone, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful world, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly glory turns to dust, an eternal glory is made ready for us in heaven. And so, with angels and archangels, we sing the hymn of your glory as we come and we exhale. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more, giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, this in memory of me.
Thank you.
We have the distribution of the Holy Communion. Those of you who wish to receive the Holy Communion, kindly come up in two lines to the center aisle, and the third be assigned by the side aisles.
Thank you.
come to the final commendation. Trusting in God, we have prayed together for Karen, and now we come to the last farewell. There is sadness in parting, but we take comfort in the hope that one day we shall see Karen again and enjoy his friendship. Although this congregation will disperse in sorrow, the mercy of God will gather us together again in the joy of his kingdom. Therefore, let us console one another in the faith and peace that we have in Jesus Christ. In baptism, Karen shared in the death and resurrection of Christ. May he now be welcomed into the glory of eternal life. As a bond of our respect for Karen, we bend his incense to Christ the God, who has called him to share in his eternal glory. Now in peace. Let us take the mantle and the gifts of our God to his place of rest.
Thank you.